So today I would like to talk about the Stangard experiment, but about spin in more detail. We have heard a lot about the spin already, so this, the purpose of this talk is to go through all these things much more systematically. To go through it first, what we know from normal quantum mechanics, from the experiments, and how that gets modeled in quantum mechanics. Also to have some reflection about what if there were certain local hidden variables that determine the spin. I mean, this will be more discussed more systematically by Jean later, but I will have some kind of very simple reflections on that already here. And then a bigger part of the talk will go to discussing spin in the various theories that we have heard so far. The many worlds interpretation, collapse theories, and Bohmian mechanics. And then finally, also especially at the example of Bohmian mechanics, I want to discuss contextuality. So this is the outline for today. Alright, so the Stangard experiment was first conducted actually very early on, so early that at that time Clearwater quantum mechanics was not yet known. So the situation you consider there is that you send the beams of neutral, not electrically charged, silver atoms in a homogeneous magnetic field towards the fluorescent screen. So we have here a source of these silver atoms, then sent to an inhomogeneous field, and you have a screen. The beams, of course, are not actually observed, but you observe in the end some pattern on the screen. The classical expectation, and I mean, you really have to forgive Stern and Gerlach here for having a classical expectation, because really not much of quantum mechanics was known at that point. I think it was before Schrodinger equation, before a lot of developments. So the kind of fair classical expectation was that particles actually carry a magnetic momentum. And as a magnetic dipole, they will first of all have some precession movement in the magnetic field. But that's not yet the relevant effect, because it's for all magnetic fields, even homogeneous ones. And then in an inhomogeneous magnetic field, they will in addition be deflected, simply because there's a stronger force on one end of the dipole than on the other end, even though it's tiny. So you can imagine like this, the source emits all these dipoles. I mean, the crawl is very schematic. You don't have to take it very literally, but roughly that's what you have. Each particle has a magnetic momentum, according to this view, and then they could all be, these are all the same kind of atoms, so kind of same kind of dipoles that you imagine, but what could differ is the orientation of their magnetic momentum. So according to what magnetic momentum they have, there will be deflected differences in this inhomogeneous magnetic field. So what you would expect is that because this magnetic momentum is random, you would expect a continuous distribution on the screen. All right. But one thing we need to add is here also so this term spin kind of derives from this idea that if you had actually an electron be charged, let's say with a sphere, and was spinning, it would have such a magnetic momentum. Of course, it's not entirely applicable here because we have neutral atoms. But still, I mean, important parts of magnetic momentum. But well, if you do now actually the experiment, you see, just two outcomes are possible. And that for any orientation of the magnetic field. So we have a kind of flat contradiction with this view that each particle carries a magnetic momentum. So this kind of completely classical idea is certainly wrong. So the conclusions that are drawn at this point usually are there is an additional property somehow which, similar to an intrinsic magnetic momentum, deflects the beam. And that property you call spin. We don't quite know what is the property of, but there'll be some additional property there of this whole situation. This property can take only two values, corresponding to possible outcomes of the Stangard experiment. Because it has only two discrete outcomes, people said like spinners on time. An interesting note here is that it's actually a definition to say a particle has spin up or spin down. It hits the screen in the upper or lower part. And often one says like spin, like gives it some actual values, then plus h bar half or minus h bar half. But it's not so important, it's just up or down. Well, okay, these are kind of fair conclusions. It's like we have to conclude. But what is really going on in the experiment? And what I want to discuss first is some kind of simple pictures. Could there be any kind of local variables that a particle by itself carries, which is kind of predefined and just revealed in any measurement? So to answer this question, you consider the following modified Chiangella experiment. So you consider kind of a succession of several such experiments with different alignments of the mechanic field. First, kind of aligned in the z direction, then in the x direction. I mean, I draw this a little bit schematically. You have to like forgive me for not actually drawing this proper three-dimensional picture. And then again in the z direction. So in the first simple model, we assume that each particle has a predefined spin z variable, which either like that should be the z was here, plus h bar half, and a predefined spin x variable, as x also either one so minus plus 1/2. And that needs to sort of, you can imagine that each particle has a little list on it, and that this list basically tells the task that spin. Stengel experiment such and such. It's like a filter. Yeah? So what would we expect then? Well, so at the beginning we think this distribution is random, so we have 50-50%. So the spin up is here just kind of ignored. We just continue if it actually has had a spin, this spin variable minus, kind of minus h bar half. And then we do this experiment. Still, it's random. So it should still be 50-50% of that which passed through there. And now we have kind of selected the, for here we have selected the spin down and for z, and here we select spin down also for x. And then we do another spin z. Now, of course, if really was just this filter action, I would expect that, well, I mean, we already filled it here, so it would have to come off only spin z down again. That would be the expectation. So the prediction is, we have, like, for the last spin z experiment, we have 0% spin z up, and 100% for spin z down. But actually, you get 50-50%. So this naive model is wrong. We can actually learn something from that here already. Namely, it's not like pure filter in all these experiments happen, but the apparatus has some influence on the outcomes of the experiment. All right. So okay, that model was very simple, so we can maybe try it like a similar model that's a little bit more sophisticated, similar in spirit. Or maybe it's like the measurement device actually has some influence, but we still have these local hidden variables. The influence as follows: it carries these each particle carries such predefined values. But if you measure, let's say, like one of them, then that one will get just filtered, but the other one will get randomized afterwards. Okay, so I mean that's another view we could have. And let's see, previously that would explain the 50-50% distribution, because if you do the other one, the spin x, that would have kind of deleted all the information about the spin x. Would have randomized it, and then we would get 50-50%. So it would kind of explain the previous situation. And now we consider a different one. Namely, we... I think this is just the same again. We consider now a different one. Namely, we do first the spin x, measurement, then a spin z, then this gets somehow recombined, I guess, by just putting an opposite field, and then we do again spin x. So what will happen then? In the first one, well, we will select the x down. Then this spin z was random and remains random. But then we do the z. And the z selects the up here, the down there. And randomizes the x again. And then we recombine. And finally do a spin x direction measurement. And then what should we get? Well, I mean, since everything was just kind of randomized earlier by that experiment, the recombination doesn't change that. We just would predict from that model that we get 50-50% distribution. Just because we previously did a spin z, and that randomized it, even though we recombined places. But the experimental frequencies are different. Experimental frequencies are 0% for spin x up, and 100% for spin x down. So also model 2 goes wrong. And interestingly, by the way, exactly the opposite way than the first one. The rule has been again for that situation, the first one would actually, I think, work. So we see like a lot of models you would kind of easily come up with, with these local variables don't work, seem to be problematic. And actually, it is indeed like there's a much deeper theorem about that. It's indeed impossible to find variables, local hidden variables of a certain kind, which will, like Jean will explain in more detail what that means. I just kind of put here a simple statement, namely, there cannot be any local hidden variables in the sense that each particle carries a set of such variables which just reveal during a measurement and which agree with the quantum formalism for spin. I mean, the quantum formalism, of course, agrees with experiments. That we know. Yeah.
And sorry, just to clarify for myself. So, but for this, you need another theory. Because, I mean.
Yeah, I didn't show it. It will just be shown in
okay.
Like
and two. This really shows would hold the same for momentum and position.
Mm-hmm.
Right, okay.
So the wheel is not there.
No.
Clearly. It's local, you can put all kind of structure and it fulfills quantum predictions. What that is this reveal. My mind should be kind of, can you more formalize what's the
reveal? Yeah, I think Jean will do that. So maybe my formulation is not optimal, but I think it's still in kind of same spirit. I think it would not, I feel this is the meaning of it. But Jean will give a more technical formulation.
So in what sense you are telling that for a single particle you have this locality? Because normally when speaking about locality we have two particles,
yeah.
Here you have one particle, and you say that even for a single particle there are problems with locality, right?
No, not necessarily.
No.
It's also like about the question of, well, I guess it has to do with locality, yeah.
No, this is...
But it also has to do with simply the influence of the measurement design on the particle.
Intrinsic might be better. I mean, hidden variables that are associated to the particle and have nothing to do with the experimental device.
But of course, if it's an associated experimental device, it's maybe you could say that some kind of an locality. But it's not exactly the same. But we will hear about this in a separate lecture. It deserves more attention and more precision. I just kind of put it here as a foreboding.
But the question was, there is this L here. What's this L might mean?
Local.
Yes.
And when you have a single particle, I don't understand what it means.
But it's not really a single particle if you have a measurement device that you just don't model. I mean, there's always the measurement device also.
Well, it means that it's not intrinsic to the particle, and he will explain it more in the rest of the lecture, so just wait a little.
Mm-hmm.
No.
But then it's not intrinsic. If it's not properly coined by two measurements, then it's not intrinsic here. But yeah, so more about this general question of local hidden variables in John and trick. All right, so how is spin then described in quantum mechanics? I just recall the usual description of spin. Well, in at least in non-relativistic quantum mechanics, you will then have a wave function which is two components spinner. So the wave function for a single particle here. So the map from r plus r3, r for time, r3 for space. It goes to some spin space, in our case that is c, isomorphic to c2. And what it will do, will take a time and x and map it to, so two component spin. So the wave function is a spinner instead of a scalar. That also means that under rotation, so an r in SO3, psi transforms according to the follows. If you do this rotation, then psi goes to psi prime, and function that is given by some matrix depending on that rotation times psi of t and r to the minus 1 and s. And these matrices, S of r, matrices forming the so-called spinorial representation of SO3. Spinorial here means it's not exactly a representation, but it will become a representation if you be a projective a Hilbert space representation, so in Hilbert space you can have a projective representation, or to put that in different mathematical terms, you can have a representation of the double cover of SO3. But these are kind of fine, relatively fine details. Then with every such spinner, we can associate a vector, if you like to, according to the following scheme. Then the omega of psi, that's this vector, is given by psi dagger times sigma psi, where the sigma are the Pauli matrices. I will have them in a second. There's a curious fact then. This vector, if you associate it, I mean, we don't say it means anything yet, yeah? Or we just like look at it as a mathematical quantity. If we rotate psi in spin space by a certain angle, theta, then omega of psi rotates by 2 theta. And angle here means that you could define angles in Hilbert space like follows, namely theta is the arcos cosine of this scalar product divided by its norm. Alright, so this is just a curious fact. Now, how does such a spinner evolve? It does evolve according to the Pauli equation. We implement a magnetic field in the Schrödinger equation. So it changes a little bit, and the essential change is here, instead of just having Laplacian, you have, you could say, a gauge covariant derivative. So in any case, the field is taken into account here, like a minimal substitution. And the B field, also taken into account here, creates an external potential term in the form like sigma dot B. Mu is the magnetic momentum, sigma is the vector of Pauli matrices, and B is the curl of A. And these Pauli matrices have that functional form. They form a certain very nice basis, those are 2x2 matrices, together with the unit matrix. And it is kind of convenient to introduce a notation for the eigenvectors of these Pauli matrices. At least for some of them, I do that here. Namely, the spin z up vector is 1, 0, spin z down is 0, 1, spin x up is this quantity and spin down that. Mm-hmm. All right, just to define what we will later be talking about. Then I would like to now discuss briefly how the wave function evolution qualitatively looks like in the Stern-Gerland experiment. I consider an initial wave function as a form psi 1 in the upper component and psi 2 in the lower. And we assume this experiment is such that psi 1 gets deflected in an up upwards direction as a wave packet and psi 2 in the downwards direction. That means we assume that dispersion and deformation of these packages are essentially negligible. We also consider, for the moment at least, a special initial wave function where initially spin and position are disentangled. So we have form of a chi, so kind of fixed spinner, times some position r. If you let that evolve according to these simplified assumptions, then the wave function after passing the detector, the screen will let it be at x equals to L. So x, the x part of this vector x. Then we will get this part where we have here chi 1 times phi, and phi is just translated, so it kind of moves, this one moved up, and the other one moved down. We assume also that they don't overlap anymore after moving apart. Then the probabilities for these two results up and down, we can cross-train over all these being in the upper wave packet and being in the lower wave packet. And you say if you are if you find a configuration in the upper wave packet, you have to go up and down for the other way. And probabilities for that are given by the Born rule according to simply the norms of these respective wave packets. And if you have this initial form like this, then they are just reduced to the complex norm as a complex 2x2 vector of chi 1. So the position part doesn't really play a role anymore.
L is the length of the standard.
Yes. So the length of when you are, when you need to like write the screen. And D is the kind of displacement with respect to the symmetry line. We're not really symmetry line, but this middle line.
So you assume that there's no phase change in the wave function, it's just displaced.
Yeah, I assume
it's
that
like a
specificity, but it wouldn't matter.
Okay,
you could even allow arbitrary deformations as long as these wave packets really don't overlap anymore.
Sure. Yeah, I just wanted to ask.
That's very simplifying.
Okay.
But the details of these simplifications actually don't matter.
Yeah.
So we can reduce these probabilities just to something that depends on chi in this particularly simple situation. And that allows us to give a very simplified description just in terms of 2x2, this 2x2 as two component spinor formalism and 2x2 matrices. Let me tell you the kind of general relation to the measurement formalism now. So let's recall the general Born rule. So that was, if an observable A is measured for a system of wave function psi, then the outcome is random with a probability distribution of the outcomes alpha, corresponding to the eigenstates of A. Rho of alpha equals sum over lambda, phi alpha lambda, psi. So these phi alpha lambda are form an orthonormal basis of eigenvectors of A. I think this lambda also takes into account the possible degeneracy of eigenvalues. Then compared to the Stern-Gerlach experiment, we see that the probabilities agree with the general Born rule for the observable A equals H bar over 2 times sigma z on the Hilbert space H equals C2. And the spinners spin up z and spin down z from an orthonormal basis of eigenvectors both.
So here, h bar over 2 is a prefactor. So sigma z is not in the denominator, it's in the numerator.
Yes, exactly. So you attain this general scheme just for a 2x2 matrix. That's very nice, and it simplifies the situation a lot compared to taking into account the kind of full position degrees of freedom. So that's why we can use this as a very simple, nice model system. We just need to talk really about these two component complex spinners without any spatial variation. All right, so let's experiment again, how it looks like in the wave function form. So I don't show again these coefficients of the wave function. So what you will get is, like from the source, these wave packets will split up then into these two parts. The spin up goes in the upper part, and the spin down goes in the lower part. And then, so if you continue with that packet, then that will kind of split up again into two. And if you continue with that one, it will again split up into two. And how it splits up, you can like kind of see from the mathematical form of these expressions, and you can calculate the probability just continuing with what you got after the last one and decomposing it again. So let's do that. So we got here, but we will know the wave function here will be spin down. So to split that up into spin z part, we just have to use in the previous formula chi equals down x. So that's the chi is the starting spinner part. That's what we start with here. And then we split that up to into these parts and take the respective projections to get the probabilities. So for example, for spin z up, we would have to take this transition probability, and I mean, all it looks like is that in actual in components is this. So you will get 1/2. And similarly for the probability into a down direction, you also get 1/2.
So you're saying that out of all the particles hitting the skin, half to up.
Yes, but also like showing you how to calculate that.
But you also count the particles on the source. How many of these particles do you see?
Okay, so I mean then it's like you have to like here a factor of 1/2, then another like factor of 1/2. So I mean in the end you have like kind of just 1/8 of that. But I was talking about the relative probabilities in the last step. So that would you could just look at how many like you're gonna get like up and how many down and you compare their relative frequencies. So I can show you how to calculate this using just the two component spinners, not the full evolution by a Pauli equation. And that's a kind of huge simplification. So, I mean, this shows, of course, how to calculate things very nicely in a simple way. But also, we see very importantly that spin gets implemented as a property of the wave function, not of the particle. Now that of course raises a question, namely, okay, we can calculate the probabilities correctly, but what is really happening in the experiment? We know from the discussion of the measurement problem that wave functions are not the full story. So in order to answer this question, what's really going on, we have to discuss precise versions of quantum theory, and I will do that for the three ones that we have got to know so far. Many worlds, GW, and homing. Let me start actually with collapse theories. And I consider, just for definiteness, GWM here. So collapse theory with mass density ontology. What that theory will use is that the same spinner wave function as before, but I mean, of course, in the full position form. And it will also modify the Pauli equation by a stochastic term which generates collapses and whose frequencies will determine their ability to produce more collapses if you have more degrees of freedom or more particles in the system. The primitive ontology for the theory is that mass density function, which projects the precise square density into three-dimensional space. So it's marginal of the precise square distribution weighted with the masses of the particles.
Maybe I should add a remark here because of the way I express things in my talk about the GRW theory and the way Matthias has expressed it here as an additional stochastic term. So I said, okay, for one instant, you just the Schrödinger equation just ceases to be valid, and you have this jump in Hilbert space. Now, you could also write this as an additional term in the Schrödinger equation, where you add a stochastic quantity that is zero almost all of the time, and then at certain times it's a delta function that gives you this jump. So this is what is meant by stochastic term.
Yeah, thank you for that clarification. But it's now important that, of course, both apparatus and object need to be modeled according to GWM to avoid the measurement problem. Because just for a kind of single particle system, that will be you have to wait forever for a collapse. So it's really important that you model the full system, only then you would get collapses. So let's look at how that experiment in GWM looks like. You consist a system. Consider a system of one silver atom and an apparatus consisting of order 10 to the 23 atoms, which register the outcome either up or down. And the evolution of the wave function will schematically look as follows. We have superposition equals superposition of spin z down plus spin z up, and the spin degree. And then I could neglect the position degree of freedom for the particle and in detector ready state, and we'll evolve to a macroscopic position, duple position, where in one part you have the spin z correlated with the detector up, and accordingly for down. Then once the superposition is generated, there's a great probability that stochastic collapse will reduce it to one of the wave targets. So because this is this detector encompasses a large degree number, a large number of degrees of freedom. So a collapse will, let's say it collapses to the up state, will just lead to this evolution. And it will also modulate that with the Gaussian, and I can neglect the detailed effects of that. But it will just essentially cross out one of these terms by an objective random process.
What is, can you visualize?
Yeah, I will do
the detector up and detector down.
I will visualize now. I mean, this was very schematic. So what you should, of course, do is do it not in a such a schematic way, but like redo it in this position space representation and take the mass density. And the mass density will really illustrate what's going on. And let me show you how that looks. Yeah, first of all, let me note really the large number of I want to emphasize that again, large number of degrees of freedom for the detector is essential, otherwise collapses would almost never happen. So before the collapse, this looks as follows. I have to explain a little bit more here. So namely, I do not model as parts of the system the source, these things that generate the magnetic field. The lines here only visualize how the wave packets travel. They're not any kind of real trajectories, only the trajectories of these wave packets. And these wave packets are not the psi function, but they are the parts of the mass density. The wave function is something high dimensional. I plot here the part of the system part of the, or no, I'm no, sorry, that simply the, no. The wave, so this meta density, you will have the contributions here and there, simply when you calculate it, and we'll also have a contribution for a detector which displays up. But this, in this very same location before the collapse, we'll have also a mass density contribution to the detector, which is down in the same place. So kind of naively, if you don't adopt the many roles interpretation, you don't know, is it up or down? So the collapse will then randomly kind of collapse the mass density to just one of these contributions of the mass for the particle, and one of these contributions of the detector, which in that case, would be then up.
You didn't visualize for me the important thing where it might happen. It's inside the detector, and you didn't describe the detector.
Why? I mean, the detector is here. There would be kind of some amount of mass density there.
No, what's your question, Len? Normal kind of detector. What's the question?
Because you know, I don't know if you're aware, but I have this paper about GRW with Dave Albert. So if you have a standard Sternbiola and many atoms excited here or there, nothing happened from GRW point of view. So you have to describe exactly what they said up to brain, GRW doesn't work, and you don't show it.
In a normal kind of detector, you would have some kind of current, like millions of electrons going in another place. You would have, they would be disjoint in configuration space.
Yeah. So this is what is not shown, but it's up down. What is the hardware?
This is a detector which consists of very many, has a very many degrees of freedom that only you see in wave function.
Many degrees of freedom are not enough. They have to be different in 10⁻⁵ cm. If they're not different, nothing happens.
Yeah. So these two electrons. They are very different, they are macroscopically different. You can even see with your eyes on the mass density that they are different.
Yeah, so what Matthias has drawn is a pointer. The pointer is pointing one way, up or down, depending on the result of the detection. And then it's certain.
It looks like from the beginning the pointer in two places. If the pointer will be like this, and then it will be one of them, then I understand. I need a pointer. Where is the pointer?
Yes.
But show only the kind of end result just before the collapse and just after the collapse. The pointer, like there will be a contribution to the mass density corresponding to the apparatus pointing up. And in the same place, mass density contribution of the detector pointing down. So kind of some kind of paradoxical, you would think, macroscopic superposition on the mass density projected into space, so it really makes precise what should happen
just
in space. And then the collapse will just reduce it to one of these.
So this picture is kind of in two times together because the wave packet is not. If you before the atom came there, the picture of the detector is different. Yes.
The upper picture is before the collapse of the macroscopic superposition. So the detector is in a superposition, and what is shown is the mass density.
I wanted to picture the detector before when it's ready.
Yeah.
Oh, there is no picture of the ready detector here.
The picture was in my slides this morning.
When one of the wave packets encounters the second detector, the real detector, there is a second collapse, right? Because the detector also collapses. So how can we be sure that the collapse is made at the same place as it is as the there was the wave packet, and that it doesn't put the wave makes the wave packet disappear or put it in another place? This configuration space.
Yeah, one collapse of these systems, as long as they are macroscopically destroyed part of configuration space, will be enough to collapse into two, one of these two.
So there's no collapse around the magnets?
And the magnets are not, like I said, I didn't model as part of the system. I just put an external electromagnetic field.
Otherwise there would be a collapse there, right?
They're always the same for both. Like in both situations, they're angry the same. They don't give a contribution that's really so relevant for this macroscopic superposition of two macroscopic disjoint states. So in both cases, the magnetic field would just be the same.
Experimentally, you have a screen, and the electrons come
out. Yeah, here I don't have a screen. I have a detector which either detects it up or down.
It is the same thing. It hits either up or it hits down. So before it hits, there is no superposition, it's nothing.
No, according to this theory, there is. It exists just for a very short time, so you can't actually see it.
What would be the representation of the detector when it's only ready without the superposition?
How would it look like? There would just be some mass. At the beginning, would just be some light packet initially where you start. And then would be this detector in some ready state. They were kind of boring. So it would, if initially we didn't have a macroscopic superposition, the mass density would look like some kind of contribution to the mass in the beginning that projects that whole spin packet, whatever it is, into just three-dimensional space, and it's at some kind of initial part. And then detector in a ready state, not in a macroscopic position at the beginning already. Or I mean, if it was not, I mean, we could just wait very, very short time and would be in a, not in a physical position anymore because of some other collapse that just happened. So I mean, that's why I didn't draw this beginning, because it's kind of boring. All right, okay, then I continue. So that was the story for the Many Worlds picture.
For GW.
For GW. Now we come to the Many Worlds picture. So here we use the Pauli equation without any modification. And I mean, at least I would here like to use also Schrödinger's Many Worlds theory by using the same mass density function. You maybe left would think that it's kind of unnecessary, but I think even if you think it's unnecessary, it makes precise what's going on in three-dimensional space. Otherwise, you might worry, yeah, how the hell can you read all stuff from a wave function to a vector in Hilbert space? It's very abstract. You have to give probably additional rules how to read out stuff from that, but I could just give that. And I guess if you think it's redundant, then at least it kind of makes it concrete for everyone else who doesn't understand how to read things out. So in many worlds, you would just have this mass density and no collapses, you would just have the same mass density. And the wave function evolution looks as before. And the picture here, just kind of when we get to the end of this experiment, well, we have this macroscopic superposition of these two wave packets, an detector being up and down, and we just have them. But it will be such that this part, which is violet, and the part gets correlated with up, behaves independently. And I'm completely unaware of that. In the same space, there's a spin down part also. And these two things we identify with a different world. So that is the kind of story in another world's interpretation. Yeah, then, I mean, it's kind of very simple, kind of a little bit unexpected that you would have in the same space very different things, but these things would not have much contact anymore. And from that, you have to figure out how to really get right probabilities and so on. That's a different story. So it seems kind of difficult, but that's the basic picture. All right. So now we can. One thing I should mention here, a crucial aspect of it is also that the detector has many degrees of freedom. So then we really have a macroscopic superposition, and in these cases, these two contributions behave as if they don't see each other, don't interfere with each other anymore. But that's important for that they would behave independently. Okay, so now we come to spin and Bohm mechanics. There, it's a kind of perhaps particularly surprising. So we've learned spin is a property of the wave function, but in Bohm mechanics, we have particles. So how does that work? So how can a particle theory cope with spin after all? Well, here's how Bohm mechanics does that. It uses also the Pauli equation, and then for the motion of the particles, the usual guidance equation gets modified a little bit. Namely, dq by dt equals a square over m, imaginary part of psi dagger nabla minus ia, a the vector of potential psi, divided by psi bar psi, and you evaluate it at all the positions at the same time. So compared to the, maybe I should write down the usual formula. The usual formula would be dq by dt equals h bar over m gradient psi over psi.
Imaginary part.
Imaginary part is a lot, yeah. Imaginary part gradient psi over psi. And now we can try to kind of rewrite that a little bit to see why the other formula is natural. First, of course, you might add here psi dagger psi bar psi star psi. So that was without spin. Of course, we could not divide with something which would be a vector. So it's kind of necessary that we add that in case we have spin. And in case it's a vector, we need this star from the necessary, because the spatial quantum current of the Pauli equation actually has that form. So in another way to see that is, in all mechanics you always have dq by dt equals j over rho, where j is the quantum probability current and rho is the probability density, and evaluated at q of t. And here it's simply the fact that the current gets modified if you have a Pauli equation and if you have an external field. All right, so that's the equation. But qualitatively, what's here very interesting is that no spin variables were introduced in addition to the particles. Spin also here is entirely a property of the wave function. But still, the question remains, is a theory of particles and nothing spinning, how can Bohm mechanics reproduce the results of the Stangerous experiment?
But this is supplemented with the shape equation for the wave case of the wave function.
Yeah, the Pauli equation.
Yeah, there's spin there.
Yeah. Yeah, the wave function contains spin.
Spin variables means hidden variables for spin. No further variables besides the wave function and the position variables.
Yeah, so I mean, that's what I mean, spin variables. I didn't mean the wave function has spin in the field. So really new variables in addition to the wave function. There, nothing like that was introduced.
So introduced by Fischer and Bohm. I think not necessary, but it was introduced.
Well,
Matthias is coming to
later,
that.
What happens then? Well, it is not necessary, but what will turn out. And we will discuss that also later. So now let me also go through how that works, this being Stangerous experiment works in Bohm mechanics. So you model the whole system, the particle that you want to kind of do the experiment on, and the apparatus via the equation of Bohm mechanics. And depending on the initial configuration, the bombing configuration of particles and detector evolves in a deterministic way, either to a configuration where the particle is in the upper curve and the detector displays up, or in a configuration where the particle is in the lower part and the detector displays the result down. So you should imagine the detector is really like made out of all kind of particles itself. The wave function is, of course, a wave function configuration space. I can't really draw that here. What I draw is only the particle part of the wave function, very schematically. And what you will have is that the particle, depending on the initial configuration, follows just one of these parts. I mean, actually, the total configuration of the whole system follows only one of these parts in configuration space. And then, but at the end, only one of these, you end up in just one of them. And the other one is macroscopically disjoint and doesn't really matter for your future time evolution anymore, so practically you can forget about it if you want. You don't have to. So the Pauli equation will never be overridden by a collapse, but if you choose to collapse, it will not influence the future time evolution anymore if you, from that point on, continue with just that part. Well, okay, that was for just one Stangerous experiment. Now let's come to maybe these more complicated situations where we saw these naive particle theories had problems with. So how, for example, does the Bohmian mechanics cope with this Z, X, Z Stangerous experiment? So that one where we have Z, X, Z. And what I draw here is the different wave packets and what the particle does. So initially you have kind of a large wave packet, a particle somewhere in that wave packet, guided by that. Then, in this first experiment, the particle has to go somewhere. These wave packets split up, so it ends up with one of them. Let's say it ends up with the lower. And these are ones I drew a little bit smaller because they have a smaller weight in the end. And then in x direction, they also split up, but in a different way. Again, the particle has to travel with one of them. And then also for the last one in Z, they like again split up and the particle has to travel with one of them. And since the initial calculation are random, the over many runs of the experiment will have a 50-50% distribution, but by in each run still the particle ends up either up or down. Okay. And also we know, yeah, so that the probabilities come out right, we also know because of the covariance property. So if you have initially an psi square distribution for kind of many kind of parallel experiments with that distribution over the experiments, and we will later also we have a bit of a psi square distribution in the end. Yes?
I don't really understand where the collapse happens, because if you
there's no collapse.
I explained this morning that there is no real collapse in Boolean mechanics.
So it's just that if you choose to, if you want to, you can neglect these parts where the particle has not been in as long as they will correspond to microscopic destroyed parts. But here it's not really like, I mean, again, it didn't show really the wave function of the apparatus. That would make it disjoint. And that would only be in the end, because in the beginning, well, didn't really speak about the apparatus much. I just showed it in a simplified description where at the moment I didn't show much about the apparatus.
Yeah, sorry, I'm really sorry, but I was still in the theory, in the tradition of Schoenberg. So when does the collapse happen in this theory?
It happens relatively soon after these degrees of freedom of the particle get really entangled with a large system. So then on they are kind of jointly a system of many particles, and if many degrees of freedom, I should say, because there are no particles in GWM. Many degrees of freedom, and because there are many degrees of freedom, collapse will happen very frequently in them.
So if you try to draw, for example, the mass density just before the measure, but inside the magnetic field, what would it look like? Is there already two separate parts, or does it need the collapse to be like this? Is there?
So in the GLW theory, with like the mass,
yeah.
So
no, in the collapse theory.
So do you mean relatively soon after that you started the experiment, or?
In between the moment that the particles passed in the field and before they were measured, because when they are measured, of course they must be
passed. Okay. So I guess like maybe like that. So this is still external geometry. Then we don't model that according to GW, and then we will have a wave packet here, the mass consisting of the mass density in there, and then the apparatus. I mean, just afterwards, the apparatus will get kind of, if starting from the ready state, these particles will have deviated a little bit.
Okay, so just before the detector, it's okay that when it encounters.
Yes, but this will be kind of a very brief time for which this will only persist. This will be kind of a very brief time which this macroscopic superposition persists. And
I think she's talking about the time before it reaches the screen.
Before?
Yeah. No.
But is it before?
Just before it reaches the screen, what does it look like? Is there already peak-like, or how can we know that it's two separate? Or is it like a continuous distribution?
Yeah, so okay, maybe like your Schumann-Schumann is a little bit broader. It's not quite there, so there's still a little bit of time. So they will kind of overlap a little bit, and this will be kind of almost, they just departed a little bit from the end.
Okay. But I just, you said that the important part is an entanglement with many degrees of freedom.
Yeah.
And it's not. You get this pointer, which is like this. Now we get a signal from here or from here. This signal will give a momentum. So the momentum, now everything is entangled, everything completely entangled. But when the pointer is still here, nothing happened. It will give superposition of momentum to the up and down. When the pointer will move out of its position, and there will be big separation, only then the GRW will work. The entanglement will do nothing until there will be separation.
Okay,
and if your pointer is very kind of wide,
you're right.
It might take a long time until the wave function of the pointer will go out of the ready state.
Yes,
this is why
it's
the ready state. The ready state is extremely important. Without ready state, you don't understand what's going on.
That's right. So it's really important where the macroscopic degrees of freedom and the many degrees of freedom just start to separate. So even like
it's special
particle,
separation.
Where it is like probably doesn't matter so much. The, what the apparatus will do will be more important because there is where the main degrees of freedom are.
The special separation of something is a problem. The entanglement of many degrees of freedom is not
but
enough.
No, but the separation that you reach like more easily if you have a, like a large degree of freedom object. So it's just something that has to be. If you have many degrees of freedom, they, each of them needs to just be placed a little bit, perhaps.
But you can have Google degrees of freedom. If they don't separate the GRW, nothing will happen.
Yeah,
they have to separate the GRW's special parameter.
They have to separate, yeah. Okay, so I mean, like also to like for Alice's question, it's actually like these many factors may well have arrived even already, and it's really like what the pointer is doing as soon as the pointer, where the many degrees of freedom, so to say, are, if they get separated, then only then the collapses start to occur. Really. Or before that, collapses will just still collapse into the same kind of state. Yeah. It's kind of hard. It's good. It would be good if someone actually made a movie or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Okay, so we were at home with Max, actually. And you see, we saw just that the Z except Schengen experiment works out. But what about of this recombination experiment? That we saw previously, we had these kind of two kind of naive views, and one of them oversatisfied. The prediction, got the predictions of one of these experiments right, but the respective other one was not right. So how does Bohm mechanics still be the other one? The recombination experiment. Okay, we again start with some weight packet that guides the initial particle via the split. Then the particle always travels one of these weight packets. Then also here we have a split and get a particle somewhere. Then, however, we don't like throw all of one of these contributions, but they just reunite again. And then, of course, like real life, also the phases will matter. So, actually, here, because they reunite, the reconstructive interference here, the constructive interference there, and then because it's destructive here, the particles actually can't go there, and will be only regarded by the remaining wave factor. Also, the wave part is also very important here.
It's actually calculated, or it's just the word.
You can also calculate that, yeah. But I'm not sure like whether people would like really, it would sound like a complicated geometry to actually calculate, but you could run a simulation. I think people have done that for lots of experiments that show analogous features to that one. But it's kind of clear that it's qualitatively will happen.
I think Polzig claims that he succeeded to make the experiment. So consensus that it's extremely difficult and no one's accepted.
To actually do this experiment. Mm-hmm.
Before in Jean's lecture, we saw for the double slits in Bohmian mechanics, for all these trajectories, GDL paths, and where it actually ended up depended on the exact starting position, which is more fine-grained than psi would give us. Is there something similar here for spin?
Exactly. So if you knew the exact starting position, you could just say where the particle will end up.
Okay, and that would be strictly in position.
Yes.
It would have nothing to do with the spin itself, being at some angle. Would be.
That's right. So the initial position, and but of course it depends also how the experimental device is set up. But the initial position together with these, all these experimental settings will just tell you exactly what the result of your experiment will be.
Okay, do you know if anyone has actually
simulated these trajectories or simulated the trajectories?
Yeah, for the case of spins, don't know that.
I think so. For just a single experiment, there are kind of Bohm trajectories that have been calculated for that.
Okay.
I think, for example, Bohm and Heide's book. The book of Bohm and Heide from Routledge, there, for example, there are like such diagrams.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Cool.
But qualitatively, well, kind of half the trajectories will up and half of them go down, but they do increase depending on the details of this inhomogeneous magnetic field. So that's how it would roughly look at it.
So the Bohmian trajectories can never cross. So
of course, it kind of crosses in configuration space. So.
Why are you saying they cross in configuration space? They don't. You said they cross in configuration space.
They cannot cross.
Ah, okay.
And if you project it sometimes, so for example, if sometimes project these pictures down to just fewer dimensions, then actually in that these situations they could perhaps cross. But in very symmetric situations, as we are considering quite symmetric situations here, then it also would not cross. So
other particles that start in the lower half of my packet will have spin down and
if you have if you have such a symmetry line there, if you actually have that, then that'd be true. If you didn't have full symmetry, they could still go around other dimensions. You would see like there would be other dimensions that they could go around and then still go right up.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, essentially yes. We will also we'll come to that very soon to this feature, whatever that implies. Okay, so I think. Okay, let's come to that now. Let's come to contextuality. And what I want to get towards is that in Bohmian mechanics, it becomes apparent that the quantum formalism has the following feature, contextuality. There can be many different experiments which nevertheless yield the same statistical outcomes. Here, let me illustrate that with an example of Stan-Gerlach type experiment. So you consider, again, Stan-Gerlach type experiments for initial wave function. Now let me have it two arbitrary initial parts. Experiment one, we do the just usual spin z up Stan-Gerlach experiment. Outcome statistics will be, so they will be designed such that psi 1 moves kind of up, and psi down moves down, psi 2 moves down. So the probabilities will be, and it otherwise doesn't get deformed really, so the probability for up is just the norm of psi 1, and the probability for down is the norm of psi 2. Second experiment. We take the Stan-Gerlach experiment, and we reverse the gradient of the magnetic field. That will make the psi 1 packet go down, and psi 2 packet go up. So to compensate for that, we relabel up and down. So simply the first packet, it goes kind of down, but now this down, because this is the kind of up part, psi, we call it again up. So to compensate for that. Okay? So then we look at the outcome statistics. So the probability for this new up is the norm of the lower part of the wave packet after the experiment, and that's psi 1, the norm of psi 1. And probability for down is the norm of the upper wave packet, the norm psi 2. So we see we can compare this to that. So Probability for up is both times psi 1 and probability norm for psi 1, and for down it's both times norm psi 2, so we get the same outcome statistic. Alright. Let's look at the paths for that position now. The first case, let's say we have an initial position that is such that maybe the psi 1 looks like that, and draw it a little different to distinguish between these two packets. So the initial conditions are for the position are such that the particle ends up in this part. Okay, then we'll get the spin up. Now we do this kind of the same experiment, but with the gradient of the magnetic field reversed. we will also relabel this up and down. But before discussing that, I need to discuss some properties of symmetric parts of wave function. Let's say the relevant process for the splitting of the wave packet is just in the z direction. We can forget about all the other dimensions for practical purposes. Then we know the Bohmian trajectories cannot cross. So we know in the first part of the experiment that such and such percent of, let's say, maybe they, let's say it's 50-50%. 50-50% come up come down. So then that would mean that they're going to upper 50% of the initial conditions. So let me like draw the initial wave packet. So after that, it splits up into different packets. And if you have initial positions there, let's say these get come out over there. And 50% of possible initial conditions. The other ones, these go down. Then we keep this initial wave function, but we change the settings of the experiments according to what is there. Since the trajectories can never cross, and these trajectories might go like that, or might go like that, I mean, we don't really know exactly what to calculate. But if the vector crosses just in that direction, they cannot cross. So really, strictly the 50% have to arrive up, and in both cases, they have to arrive in the, not, let's maybe not say up, but they have to arrive in this upper part. And now let's look at this, what it looks like in the experiment. So this reflects a different gradient. And now the Psi 2 wave packet arrives in the upper position. And the particle, because it was initially up, it does no choice of also going in the upper part again. But the upper part now means down. Yeah, because it's guided by the down part of the wave packet. So the same initial conditions lead to two different results in two experiments. The same initial conditions for the particle, of course, for the rest it's not the same. So we actually get what I said. But the conclusions are Bohmian particles don't have an intrinsic spin value. Spin is a particle which kind of changes very easily according to the circumstances. Spin is a property of the wave packet by which the particles are guided. And different experimental setups can make the same initial conditions lead to different outcomes for spin measurements, even though the outcome statistics are the same. So we get this property contextuality. There can be many different experiments, which nevertheless give the same statistics of outcomes. And the lesson is to be learned here, namely that operator observables represent equivalence classes of experiments with the same outcome statistics. So I have to add this background that to do these calculations, you would both time use the same operator, the Pauli spin that matrix to calculate these things. It's both times the same outcome statistics, you use the same operator observable, but still for two different experiments.
Yeah, I'd like to emphasize one thing here. So Matthias wrote, these two experiments have the same statistics of outcomes, same probability of result up and result down. What I'd like to emphasize is this is so for every wave function. So you feed this experiment with some wave function that has 30% up and 70% down, you get, in both experiments, you get probability 30% of outcome up and 70% of outcome down. But the two experiments are different experiments, and they will actually yield different results in the same when applied to the same initial conditions of the Bohmian particle.
Both the position of the wave function.
Both the position. You could have yes the same initial data for both the position and the wave function. Yes.
But so you said it's true for one particle, right? Because so for one particle that has the same starting position, you would get, I mean, I find it difficult what you said, because there cannot be, the wave function fixes the initial conditions, right? Because of the equilibrium. So basically...
Wait. When you say the wave function fixes the initial condition, you have in mind choosing the initial condition, the initial position with psi squared distribution.
Exactly.
Yeah, what I'm talking about is for a specific initial position.
So if you have only one particle.
Yes.
Yeah.
So,
but then, what is the meaning of probability 30% when it's a deterministic theory?
Okay. So I'm making two statements.
Yeah.
One statement is when you have when you choose the initial position at random with psi squared probabilities,
okay,
then you get certain outcomes with certain probabilities. and the two experiments yield the same probabilities for every wave function for the single particle.
Okay.
Second statement is about applying the two different experiments to the exact same initial conditions for the particle. So there you consider a specific initial position and specific wave function, and you repeat the experiment mathematically or in a computer simulation. Since the theory is deterministic, you can ask the question, what would have happened if I had applied the other experiment to the same initial situation? And the result is you get a different outcome of the experiment, which just reflects that there are two different experiments.
If it's 50-50, it's always different. If it's 30-70, it's not always different.
It's sometimes different. So at least it can be different. There are some cases in which it's different, yes.
So to summarize, there is no map from the total Bohmian state of the particle position and wave function to spin values.
Although there is a map from the initial position and the initial wave function to the outcome if you consider a specific experiment. So here we see different possible choices of experiment for the same observable. The observable here is sigma z. So we have two experiments, both of which are quantum measurements of sigma z, but they're two different experiments.
So observable, not observable, measurement, not measurable.
Okay, so there's one further thing before I actually come to the end that I wanted to look at, namely also what was asked before. I mean, what happens if we actually do introduce additional spin variables for Bohmian mechanics? So we could just could do that. We could introduce an actual spin vector in addition to the position. And here that is how Bohm and collaborators did that. Is that in each particle, we just have one here for simplicity, has an actual spin vector which is given by the following formula. And we're taking that spin vector that I wrote down before for any spinner. Now we have a size of field. We evaluate that at the actual configuration of the particle. That just kind of gives us a spin, a certain vector in R3 for each time. We could imagine that this vector is attached to the particle. Okay, then this thing will have the following properties. That spin vector always points in the direction up and down or down associated with the end position in this spin. In this Stengel experiment. So again, that's at least what we guess would like to have. It also is true that this S of t does not influence the position q of t. And contrary to the position, this S of t is actually redundant. In both versions of Bohmian mechanics, this one and the previous one, the experimental device reacts exactly in the same way, whether or not you have the spin vector or not. So you could kind of just leave it away and still get the same result. So I guess that's why people don't take such a spin vector. You can add it if you want to, but it's completely redundant to get that the measurement device will display the correct results.
So
yeah,
when you do take these two different orientation of the Stengel, then you will get two different results for the spin, too? For this spin vector, too?
So it will be so that, I think there are also two different ones. And then we go back to the picture, because it depends on the wave packet, what the spin vector is. The wave packet at the position of the particle. So
yeah.
Here we'll have, the psi 1 will define it was the up part. Will define what the spin vector is for this particle. And then the other case, the particle was guided by the down part, so it will display also down. Yeah, it will also display two different spin vectors in the end.
I see, okay. So they just go for a ride.
Yeah. Yeah, because the spin vectors just going to drive in the particle for free and without doing anything. Okay, so that is the last thing I wanted to say. Thank you. Are there more questions? Yeah.
I don't know if I'm getting this precisely enough, but what about the argument that this refers to the DRW version of the Young experiment? That's a collapse in the experimental device. It's not the right type of collapse because something in momentum space will have to collapse. But what we need is something in position space that will have to collapse. And as far as I got it, the argument goes that when the collapse in the experimental device, that cannot be the type of thing that gives us a definite outcome. Then we have to go back into the observer's retina, into the observer's brain, and find eventually, we have to postulate that the observer's brain, so to speak, it would have a definite position as a product, as a causal effect of the entanglement with the particle that hits the screen and the experimental device. So I just don't know whether I got it right. I think it's something that you worked on, I'm not sure, but...
So I would think kind of reasonable measurement devices are such that they create macroscopic superpositions input, like which are disjoint in the position configuration space, and then a collapse is just enough to produce just one result. I think you don't have to go so far.
So the question was simple. You can arrange the one which doesn't do this, and then you have to wait until...
I guess you would say, then either you have to wait, or you could just say that actual measurement devices which you use are not like that.
But the screen is more or less like this. The pointer is not like this. Pointer makes the GRW collapse. Screen in principle doesn't, unless you have some.
Okay, so perhaps for certain measurement devices you would have to go further? So
exactly. This is a minus of GRW. You would expect that it will make collapse if it doesn't. But until the observation comes to human beings, it does. But then some people that you need human being for collapse. It is.
Well, I guess you don't really. I mean, you have to pause it, reflect kind of everyone's experience correctly. I mean, that as humans is not, I mean, that's where we collect our experience. So at that level, it certainly has to be rewrite. But I think otherwise, it doesn't get a special status to humans. It wants it in the same way as the experimental device. So I don't see a particular problem, even if you have to go that far.
But you can imagine conscious being with brain, with spins, and then no GRW collapse.
So it depends on the type of device.
Yeah, you need special separation. Okay, many particles, specially separated, more than the 10⁻⁵ or whatever. Now it's much smaller because experiments show that 10⁻⁵ is not good.
Okay. Yeah. More questions?
Yeah. I have a question generally about Bohmian mechanics. So what is the reason that we assume the equilibrium distribution at the beginning in some type? Do we just have to assume it, or is there a reason for this?
Okay, but if I can like answer in different ways, first of all, if you assume it, then you get the quantum statistics, so it's kind of, it does something for you, it's kind of would postulate in that sense. But of course you might answer like why, like is there, could there be a deeper justification of it? The answer is yes, there can be a deeper justification. And you can in a certain way derive that, assuming that you describe the whole universe in kind of a really large system, and look at the wave function of that system, and that wave function defines your typicality measure on initial conditions. And with respect to that typicality measure, kind of typical subsystems actually are psi squared distributed according to their subsystem wave function, which you can define precisely the Bohm mechanics. So we have a large wave function for the whole system and then kind of some kind of conditional or effective wave function for a smaller system, and you can show the statement that typicality would be defined by the wave function of the large system. The smaller system have psi square distribution according to the little psi square. That's a paper by Dürer, Walshein, and Zandi called quantum equilibrium and the origin of uncertainty. Yeah.
But yes. You have to assume the psi square distribution on the big system.
Yeah.
So there's a consistency.
It is a certain kind of consistency, yeah. But it's also something you really show there.
Yeah, it's like a law of large numbers.
It's also not really a system. The whole system, the big system, of course, is not like you have multiple copies of it. You have just one copy, so there the psi squared has a different status than the psi squared of the little system. They could imagine really many little systems distributed actually like that.
So this law of large numbers statement would be as follows. If for the universe as a whole, you pick at the beginning of the universe, the configuration of the universe at random with psi square distribution, then throughout the history of the universe, for all experiments that all physicists are ever doing, all the results, all the statistics look like Born rule statistics with probability near one. So there are some initial configurations for which you get strange statistics, but with probability near one, if you pick the initial configuration of the universe, the psi square distribution, then kind of everything comes out the way we see it.
Yeah, there is another argument which my friends don't like, I think, which is that even if you start with a non-equilibrium distribution, then at least numerically you can, in simple models, you can show that there is convergence to equilibrium.
But that's right, that's also nice evidence. Yeah.
What?
There's also nice evidence.
So this is Valentini, and this is somewhat controversial because it looks like he makes many systems and they use others, a kind of normal.
I think actually Hans Westman did these simulations.
Yeah, it's Westman.
Not Valentini.
Hans Westman, we had talks about that in
the
time. But Valentini, this is the main.
No, Valentini. Valentini also. You see, Valentini tried to derive a Boltzmann type equation that would show convergence to equilibrium, but that I think is not terribly convincing.
Yeah,
but there is numerical evidence from Westman and others, and Westman was talking when we were inside.
Yeah.
So, can you clarify what's the difference? If I understand that the Valentini, what I knew, I did not claim that if you start not with. Not with equilibrium, then for some reason, for complicated enough system at least, then you come to equilibrium anyway. So you don't need this additional postulate. For example, Aronoff really doesn't, Aronoff was working with Bohm, but he doesn't like Bohmian theory at all, but mainly because of this original assumption that you have to postulate this random Bohmian position according to Born rule. And Valentini was trying to claim that you don't need it. And you say, is that Westman says something different?
No. It's the same thing, but the argument is numerical in simple situation, where Valentini was trying to give a general argument based on a Boltzmann type equation, but that I think is not so strong, this argument, the proof of Boltzmann equation. Is that
correct?
No, I think it's
correct.
It's completely misleading to say that Valentini somehow show that you can drop this assumption or that you don't need it. That's a kind of misleading, that's a misrepresentation. Yes, I guess you learned it from Valentini.
Yes.
You just said it, so I'm objecting to that. Yes.
Very nice, in a big workshop in Italy, in Italian, kind of Toscana, and I think it was very clear from him that this is exactly the statement.
Yeah, so that's a misrepresentation. It's misleading.
No, it's not a misrepresentation by you. He says that Valentini misrepresents the situation, not you.
Ah,
okay. Yeah.
Okay,
but
here we express the same, that I'm skeptical, so here we go.
Yeah, but this topic is requires a longer discussion.
Yeah, I mean, you can say like there's some arguments for the justification of psi square as a initial distribution. More questions?
I just had comments. I like that we need I claim that we need board rule for everything. So if somebody will say that for some interpretation we don't have to postulate, I will be somewhat upset. I claim that the border would have to be postulated at any interpretation.
Well, in some sense.
Okay, this topic we can continue during the coffee break. Let's thank Matthias again. We'll meet again in 20 minutes.